our site is right on the edge of the Apennine Mountains, so we have this foothills condition, and we have a relationship to some major Italian cities, specifically Florence and Lucca. And if you guys know exactly where they are on that, Jan made this map, so didn't notate them specifically.
Lucca's on the coast.
Yeah,
is that way.
Yeah, so Lucca's going to be up here.
Florence is just up here.
Okay, yeah. Florence is just over here. So we're kind of between these two, and since it's Europe, we hypothesize that one of the major ways to get to our site would be with a train. And you wouldn't actually take the train to Collodi, which is where we are, but you'd take the train to Pescia. And then you have to take a bus around the mountain. So if we zoom in a little bit more, this now represents Phoenix in its entirety, and our site's in the middle here. And we have Pescia on here on this side of the mountain, and then Collodi sort of around the other side of this smaller ridge that cuts it off. So we are have this slightly more isolated area. And you take a bus, or you can actually walk from Pescia. And it takes about the same amount of time. You either walk over the mountain or take a bus all the way around the bottom of the mountain. Zooming a little bit more, this is just sort of this would be 1 to 800, so this would be 1 to 1600, sort of site plan of what we have going on. Our site appears right here in the center. This is sort of the major part of Collodi. It's in the lowest part of the valley here. And this is this is very specific. This is the Pinocchio Park. And then our site will go into a little bit more in detail. But Pescia exists on this side, which would be on the other side of a ridge here. We looked at some cultural stuff. I don't know if Richard can talk about culture a little bit.
Yeah, I can do culture. Collodi, basically, it's a 12th century medieval town, and it's one of the, it's not by any case a rare thing, but it is one of those well-preserved medieval towns in Italy. So that's really what it's known for. It has this sort of character of a 12th century medieval town. So the basis, it was set up with a castle on the top of the mountain, which would be, and then everything else sort of cascaded down the hillside from there, moving in this direction. And so the historically it was important because it was a border. It was geopolitically important. And then afterwards, the main sort of industry was botanical gardens. And then obviously, Carlo Collodi wrote Pinocchio, lived here for a significant portion of his life. And so the site that we have is sort of right in the center, sort of like straddles this main access way, which is split into two. And so the main bus route into town will sort of take you out this way and then back out this way. And then so this would be industrial. There's two main churches. And then our site, which has a paper factory, is sort of straddling right in the middle of this section here. So
yeah, in this region, somebody discovered sort of a new way to make paper, and it was actually more like papyrus in a sense. It was actually made out of like grass, hay, essentially. So they weren't using pulp, and the paper, I believe, was used more for packaging and stuff like that. It wasn't really used to be printed on. But that's why we have this paper factory, and a lot of sort of smaller versions of this basically started existing in a lot of places. And it's pretty cool. On the top floor, they used it for drying, so it has these really cool, tall, super elongated kind of Gothic windows. So you can kind of see that in some people's drawings and models later. So this existed as a paper factory for a while, and then it obviously isn't anymore. It's sort of a ruin now, which is kind of cool.
And can you point that out, just one thing on the image, and also just existing image on the site as well?
So this is the hamlet up here with the villa and then the residential buildings sort of cascading down the hill from the castle at the top. So this is the view from the little town of Collodi up the hill. This is the paper factory that we that's on our site that we had the ability to use if we wanted to. So this is its current state, and this is a view of the river that bisects our site.
Yeah, so here's site and that, or here's like environmental analysis. We're not going to go too much into that. It's sort of sister climate is
Chico, California.
Yeah, that's sort of our,
in short, it's a Mediterranean climate, mild temperatures year round. I think summers, the warmest temperatures are in the like low 80s. Winters, upper 40s, low 50s, 35 inches of rain a year. So generally,
ocean, desert climate. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So yeah, just going a little bit beyond here, this is a more zoomed in site plan, and then we have site sections right here. But if we look at the model here too, here is that sort of what's called a, sort of a villa, but it sort of snakes up the mountain to the originally the fortification. So this is an interesting condition here. These buildings are built sort of on a ridge, and it was originally for of the fortification for defensive purposes. And then the later development exists sort of in this low, flatter, much easier to build on land, which is where our site is. And as Richard pointed out, we're sort of cut in half by the river. And I guess we can start talking a little bit more about the brief. Matthew talked a little bit about some of the areas, but we weren't allowed to cover the river, was something they were very specific about, and we weren't supposed to build underneath sort of the level of the water, but we could go down somewhat. But at the same time, there's no height limit, and you'll see what that means when our student hears that there's no height limit.
No.
So also, this...
Oh, and the 250 car parking requirement as well.
Yes.
So there is a significant amount of automotive infrastructure to deal with as well.
So right here, this building and some of this represents the Carlo Collodi Foundation. So that proximity, I think, was something a lot of people were thinking about, like what that means. We're not, you know, just blocking that whole thing out entirely. So that's essentially the client on this project. I mean, that's something we need to think about and how they, you know, what they're interested in seeing.
And also just a little anecdote about that villa up on the mountain is Carlo Collodi's parents both worked there as sort of helpers and servants to the royal family that lived there. And so he was actually born out of the relationship that was formed there. So our site is kind of in between the current Collodi Foundation and then like the roots of Carlo Collodi and his family. So you can see it as it kind of like intersects those two axes.
And on that note, Pinocchio in the story is just a huge part of this town. There's a statue of Pinocchio about right there that welcomes you as you drive in, this being the main route into town.
The tallest statue of Pinocchio anywhere in the world.
Gotta be. and just another thing, our program calls for a library, exhibition space, sort of... mixed media workshop type space and cafe. This is part of a much larger vision for the town of Collodi, where it's part amusement park. The existing Pinocchio Park, did we talk about that?
I think
Richard mentioned that. So right here is a kids park that's in existence now. So it's kind of trails through the forest, a couple bridges that go across, and some sculptural elements that are pulled from the story of Pinocchio. And so the plan is to really take this fairy tale concept, starting with Pinocchio, and turn it into like an international tourist hub. At least that's the vision. This being the first part of that.
So here's a little 3D print of some of the existing buildings on the site. And there's the main sort of slab running through the middle, which is the paper factory, which has those really cool windows and stuff I mentioned briefly. But some of these auxiliary structures that exist around it are not nearly as historic and in pretty rough shape. A lot of it, I mean, it's falling apart, like the actual, this main paper factory part of it is missing a roof in the middle of it. There's sort of these later built structures that are deteriorating pretty dramatically. And the brief said we couldn't tear down the paper factory, we can't get rid of it. But some of those auxiliary structures, they were a little bit more vague about, so some of us have removed some of those things that were just kind of a nightmare. Also, on the other side of the river right here, there's some old, like, light steel frame. They were greenhouses. So they're just the steel frame standing there. As far as we can tell, there's essentially no foundation. So you can see those more specifically in the site plan right here, but there wasn't structure or anything that we could really build on. So if anybody reacted to that, it was more in form, I think, than reutilizing those.
And the site slightly slopes, continuing down the mountain line. So on the other side of the river, it's about 3 meters lower than on the side where the paper factory is.
think that's pretty much our site analysis.
Yeah, if that's it, if there's any questions, then feel free to jump in, but most of it will become clear once you guys start talking about your initial solution. So whoever wants up first, you're welcome.
The volunteers? Should we just go this way?
Start.
Okay.
Site analysis, and we did some precedent studies of libraries and everything. I was really interested in sort of looking at the context, and I very quickly decided that I didn't want to go too high, but I also didn't want to create a huge building that was sort of dwarf the context. So I essentially fragmented the program and just made it into initially really just small blocks. And then when I started thinking about circulation, exiting, and stuff, a lot of the blocks started fusing back together. But I have some diagrams of different kinds of stuff that I'll talk a little bit more about the model. I really wanted to make this library and place in general for the community, for Kelowna, as well as for the tourists. So I created essentially a public plaza, and we have an auditorium program. It's 250 seats, which is not huge, but I really want to make that accessible to the community just right here and allow them to potentially use that space as well. So I kind of opened up right through the center, and I wanted to bring that closer sort of to the water too. What they call the river, but it's really more of a small stream, is really isolated from the city. It's relatively deep, in a lot of places it's really walled in for some storm, like flood control and things like that. So I actually lowered this plaza on my site about 4 meters. Originally it was much more, but it became really hard to deal with. So it associates more with the water, and I want to kind of bring my buildings together around that central space. And we also have Pinocchio Park coming down here, so I wanted to extend that coming down onto this portion of our site. So I've taken the 250 cars and I've put them on two layers underneath that level. Two layers is about all I could fit down and not go below the river. But then it allows me to put vegetation and stuff over that over this whole portion of the site with the parking underneath. And I think that way I'm not blocking off the foundation too much, because it is, at the end of the day, they are going to want to be able to kind of see across here. Apparently they have a view of this vegetated area, and the paper factory is sticking up. So I want to sort of maintain some of that while working in the site. So I have the auditorium for the community, and then the library. I wanted to bring more into with the associate more with the paper factory. The roof is already falling off the paper factory, and it has a really interesting feel that when you look through the windows from the outside, you can look straight through the roof and outside again. So I actually took the entire roof off the paper factory, and I'm making it into essentially a court. And it has these really cool window openings, as I mentioned, but then allow that to be more of a reading, an outdoor reading space, because it seems to be a pretty nice climate. They do get a pretty decent amount of rain, but whenever it's not raining, this would be a really cool space to hang out and read, essentially. So people were talking a little bit about, you know, libraries and if they really need to have books and stuff. I'm a little bit of a traditionalist. I want to have books in my library, so I do imagine people actually taking a physical paper object and take it outside and actually spend some time with it. This is different drawing showing how the section and stuff works and creating that public space and how I broke up some of the program. Here's the parking and stuff underneath there, and then some of the diagrams and stuff I made. I think that's pretty much where I am right now. I redrew a lot of the context and stuff to try to understand exactly how these things grew. And at one point I had a very sort of idiosyncratic site plan of very different shaped volumes and stuff that looked a lot more like the context. And it got a little bit too crazy. I had to kind of reel that back in. So now much more orthogonal plan. I'm going to have sort of a series of a primary court and then, you know, secondary courts and tertiary courts to, with a sense of scale, try to make you understand how you progress into the more and more intimate areas versus the main public space in the session. Have any questions?
Maybe just to clarify, because you mentioned this was, you know, for the community things, could you sort of just give us a little quick overview of how you imagine people approaching if they're coming maybe from this place versus coming from a vehicle? What's your approach vector like? What experiences do you encounter along the way, and how are you curating that approach?
Okay, so if you came on the bus, which is one of the things that seems to be a primary access, you come up and there's a bus stop right here, a little bit higher up here. Very close to the front of our site, and I've created a kind of a smaller plaza right there in front, so it makes a nicer place to kind of get out of the bus. But I've called that kind of pedestrian access. There's community restaurants in sort of the downtown of Kolodi, although it's, you know, it associates a lot with Pesha on this side of the mountain. But there is sort of the more downtown area. So I imagine that's more where people would walk. I also wanted to create a bridge directly from Pinocchio Park over here. But if you came in a car, you'd come up here and park, and then you'd come through this primary bridge. And that's where I put the cafe program. So I actually ended up making it 3 stories tall, and the cafe would exist in the center. And you can come directly out of the parking and circulate through that, or if you will, to go up in that volume and go into the cafe. And then the top floor of that becomes essentially a viewing platform where you can look out over all of the whole library and kind of help you understand how it's arranged. There's, in addition to the paper factory, there's this cool little tower right here that I've worked around to incorporate, and I want to make into essentially a play structure for kids. So it exists in this court, and it will stick up above all the other buildings. So you'll be able to see those different moves in a different language. I don't really have like materiality and stuff figured out, but I do want to play on the difference and sort of show what's old and what's new.
In the brief, it was mentioned about Pinocchio and, you know, the story of Pinocchio and the Pinocchio Park and everything. Did anyone deal with that metaphor or anything about that story in their plan that, you know, with the risk of it trying to be Disneyland-like or not, you know, not letting it become Disneyland-like, but does that come into, did you think anything about that, or did anyone?
I think definitely people will. I don't know exactly where everybody's at right now, so I can't really speak to that, but I was looking more at sort of the place that inspired Carlo Collodi to write, and not so much the literal story. There's also a lot of different versions of that. I mean, I think many of us watched the Disney movie, but we also read it in different forms. People found a lot of different translations of it that, you know, seem very, very different. But also, digging into the history of sort of, you know, different versions that happened. I think in the original version, Pinocchio dying.
Yeah, it's
like all the little animals that he, you know, mid-streets like hanging at the end. So there's a lot of different things going on there. So So I don't, I didn't personally react to that so much. We have within sort of the exhibition space is what they call a media space and a workshop and an exhibition space, but it seems like kind of a bunch of different types of exhibition, from things that could be kind of augmented reality to more, you know, traditional, you know, like exhibition cases and, you know, with artifacts in them. The foundation has a bunch of stuff that they have had donated, from antique toys and different things that were inspired by the story of Pinocchio. So they want to exhibit those sort of artifacts in there.
Yeah. But Pinocchio, yeah, and Pinocchio does kind of go out into the world and experience this. Mm-hmm. So, okay.
Do you imagine you're going to use that? Or no? You're saying you're not sure because of what you read? I mean, I think it's an interesting comment because, like, it's a, I have to come in on you because there seems to be a rigor, right? You guys do site analysis, understanding context. There seems to be essence of building, right? But it's like, where are we going to go from this? Things that I would consider, this is midterm, right, mm-hmm. is to totally just embrace that story, right? This is a place for children. There's so many different things you can grasp from that conversation. For instance, like, architecture tends to be a lot, you know, a lot of things, but most of the time it's things that we see, and so it's you have to start to ask yourself, how is this thing going to start to operate, let's say, graphically or visually in some sense? So conversations around, let's say, cartoons, right? Like, do you want to steal stuff from cartoons, or is this building from cartoons? Or even the sense that this is a kind of Disneyland, right, within the city that might be different? Or is it something completely opposite, where it sits, you know, it's kind of hides in the site? I almost wish you would, like, look at children, right, and how children play. They don't really care. Right? They're just going to make things, just going to do things. And so maybe that's something you need to start looking at. It's like you set up the framework. There seems to be a building, right? And so now start to develop some type of conversation with yourself, maybe a set of rules on how you start to, let's say, operate within the frame of the site. Right? So the context is done, the cartoon is done, the masking. Now you're really looking at this as kind of a drawing. The site is a drawing, and it's, you have to figure out how you want to operate within that context. Like, if I was doing it, I would go up to three kids and say, can you sketch me three pieces of paper, draw me something, and then use that as a kind of esquisse to figure out some type of sensibility, things like color, things like graphic. Like, I really like the diagram in the middle. I don't know if that's program, the drawing in the middle.
This is
like, there's a graphic sensibility to it, right, which I wish was actually on the buildings, you know? I think you've set up a really great, rich conversation about how your position is formally, but I think you have to start looking at details. And maybe going back to that initial comment about looking at the narrative, right? Are you going to use this? I think it could be a productive tool, right, in the future.
There were three kind of moments where my ears perked up a little bit, and they all had to do around this concept of what I would say is interiority. And you described this in urban scale, building scale, and then briefly mentioned how it would operate actually being inside your kind of cochet, your nulli plan. But I think highlighting those three aspects, and they came through with this space where you said it was the kind of grand public moment. Right now, choir is at about the same level as every other space. Like, it's slightly bigger, but it's not really claiming its own identity. And the same goes for this would be the kind of building scale interiority, where I think it's actually a kind of brilliant move to hollow out this old building and actually turn that into a piazza, right? Like, piazzas are traditionally made from buildings, you know, framing a space. And what you're doing is flipping that and inverting it and saying, right, the building that used to be interior is now going to be a plaza that's interior of other buildings, right? Mm-hmm. So I think those, like, what is a piazza? What is a public space? And then what defines a building? Like, that's a really interesting tension you have going on there. And I would play that out even more with what now are just the dark masses. Like, what is the inside of this thing, right? Are these thick walls? Are they paper thin? Is it just kind of, are you framing this and it's actually just hollow? Because I think, you know, not to play on the trope of, like, the nobly plan and being very spaces are actually, you know, hollow and they have a kind of life inside. So I would challenge you to see, to run this kind of your flows through all of these spaces and see what they mean. And I think they mean different things, right? I think you're setting up a really interesting definition of these parts, and you gotta like give them, you know, that kind of presence and let them stand on their own, but then collectively.
Right? Just to expand on that too, I mean, we all keep going back to this diagram over here, and at the end of your presentation, you're like, oh, and I did these diagrams. Right? So in, I guess what, you know, this says, I guess, as a, you know, moving forward, take stock in those modes of representation, something Ryan was touching upon. If you want to go down the path of a cartoonish sensibility, then the model should start addressing that as an aesthetic. The diagram should work its way through that, like cartoon logic, basically, and so forth. And maybe, again, if that's the route you wish to go, that's where kind of the fruitfulness of the actual, like, participating in that drawing, actually investing in that drawing, actually going through the diagram, might lend itself to those opportunities moving forward. And, you know, it's fascinating because you all said that this Pinocchio part was super strange and weird and so forth, right? And I think that's a total cue. Like, there's certain things that are no-brainers. Like, I'll go to an amusement park and be like, oh, this Harry Potter cast was fantastic. And then we don't, like, when we start talking about architecture, it's like, oh, but you don't do that kind of thing. But I would do the, you know, take the cues from that. There's something magical about this kind of artificial and the natural that happens in these kind of play parts, especially in Italy. And then, you know, talking about Italian literature as far as fairy tales go, you know, I'm a big Calvino fan. We were talking kind of sidebar about it too, but like there's a sense of magical realism where they can take a trash can and make you believe the trash can is the most beautiful thing in the world and have this lush story that you can totally feed off of. So yeah, take stock in like kind of the tchotchke things or the banal or the mundane of the site, which is that Pinocchio part I would argue. So.
Yeah, you're at the limits of what a massive study can achieve at this point. And I think everyone seems to be on board with the general massing. It makes sense given the context. And you can take a stab at the bottom up, the surrogate detail or tectonic set of relationships, kind of work that up through to see how your massing starts to react to that. And I would also want you to consider designing those void spaces, right? But more than just, as you've represented, just a blank space, right? You need to have a character to them. You have the Pinocchio Park, which could, I don't know if this is how accurate this density is, but kind of feathering that into the site almost like one way to maybe start to think about how those in-between spaces start to take shape. It's a really lovely idea what you're doing with the paper factory, like this brilliant or the shell, you're inverted, you know, the typical expectation. That sort of thinking, this ambiguity between inside and outside can kind of play out through the entirety of the scheme in some way. So really, then maybe it goes back to that, the tectonic relationship, the detail, the way that it's separated.
So something interesting about when we first were looking at the program, I separated into four categories about basically the light, and I didn't want to do what France did and put all the books in big glass tower and let them all get deteriorated by the UV light. So I came with four categories. I said we have areas that are non-essential to have natural light, and then areas that I consider to be essential, and then looked at areas that have direct light and indirect light. I have a tremendous amount that will have either no light or indirect light. So I was thinking about, I mean, when we started kind of getting into materiality, about, you know, north openings and using some sort of foggy glass and different things like that to kind of control the light.
Giving yourself a system.
Yeah, so that would definitely start informing what this really looks like, but I haven't figured that out yet.
One other thing I wanted to point out, and I don't know, I don't fully understand how the traffic circulation will work, but this seems like this is a huge parking structure, assuming that people are parking here at the library, you know, it's a large volume, this is a really weak point. I think it's exciting that you're kind of misdirecting people and making more of a labyrinthian experience, but this is an important node here at this bridge that just show guess it needs to fit into the kind of overall logic of the scale of the park you developed, but I think that's a really crucial point that needs to be explored. And you got a sense that it's more pedestrian or more parking, or is it unclear how people are going to be entering into the space?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's I honestly expect a lot of pedestrians and people coming in on the bus. It seems like a lot of parking. But at the same time, there's parking that's up here right now that's for Pinocchio Park. And I would think that maybe we could, you know, some of that could go away, the surface parking. People could utilize this underground parking for the greater.
So parking the area at large, or is parking specific to the library project?
It doesn't really say, I don't think, but I'm basically saying that everything is for the whole community.
You know, it's funny, the model was white, right? It would really just blend in with and I think just hearing all the comments, I mean, there's different ways you could treat that, but on one hand, you could really treat this as a kind of project where it camouflages in with the city, and it's the interior that starts to speak about the project, right? So you can't really understand it through, let's say, a set of interior elevations or perspectives as far as what the kind of program is, versus kind of conversation with outdoor space, or piazzas, or circulation, whatever it is. I think you have to make a decision like how you really want to operate within the context, because the way you're setting up, it seems so friendly to everything, and I don't know if that's what it wants to be in some ways. You know, maybe it doesn't want to be friendly, or if it does, then the interior maybe doesn't want to be a different world, kind of paying to go into a different, let's say, universe in some ways. But I don't know if the massing is quite there yet for me. Like, why didn't we go high? Why so low? I know you mentioned it in the context, but why did you need to do that? Did you think about doing other schemes or other massing studies besides?
I thought about going really deep. I had no building sticking up above the original surface of the site. And then it didn't really fit with getting into down below the river, and it became really hard to get people down to that level because we were like 10 meters in the ground. So I was going sort of an extreme in the opposite direction and really burying
it. I think it works because you used to, this interstitial space starts to become kind of a blank canvas, right? Instead of a kind of open single gesture, it's a bunch of little mini exterior rooms kind of in between other interior rooms in some ways. And so I'd really encourage you to like make that decision early on so you can really develop it. You know, figure out what this thing wants to look like on the inside as well on the outside. And I think it'll turn out great, but I would suggest maybe just one more pass at really understanding how it's going to be in the context. Because for me, it's almost like if this thing was white, it's like, where's the project?
Yeah.
You know?
If the massing you have right now was white and the parking structure was like acrylic, I'd be wanting to ask you about the parking structure instead of the rest of your project. I think pointing it out on this massing diagram, like, there is something really interesting about your decision of this kind of parking slab in juxtaposition to your project, because it's the thing that contains it. Like, your building can't cross the river because this thing's holding it in a way. So there is this tension that it's the force that is limiting this kind of false expansion and growth of the city. And in that sense, it's not a passive player, right? It's not just the place you park. It's very much, you know, the beginning of the experience and the way that you would read this project. Like, you come in this kind of sleek structure from today, from contemporary today, and then pass into this kind of nostalgia in a way. And that sets up a kind of the Disney context that we're all kind of driving in and have our tablets, and then we like move into the fantasy. So I think you got to be careful with that, and or at least figure out a way that the two either speak the same language, or you actually accelerate that kind of discrepancy between the two and make it part of what you're doing. But I think totally play with some of the massing too. I don't think it's exactly there. Like, they push it, like, see how tall this thing can go, see how short it. That's one thing I'm totally missing from the project, and maybe this will be explained later, but like, what is the scale of a person? There's not a single person. basing it on my understanding of the size of a car right now, which is a whole different way of thinking urbanistically, that it's, like, in some ways, this is very much an urban project based around a car instead of being the kind of pedestrian city that you're describing.
You know, I think the problem maybe that we're all getting, and it's not a problem necessarily, like, you know, the mass seems exhausting itself as a programmatic exercise to find relationships and somewhat of a narrative how to work through this thing and so forth. And, you know, again, it's midterm, so that's not a shocking expectation at all. But I guess we're all chomping at the bit, I guess, to hear from you maybe. Like, where are your thoughts moving forward? Like, is this literally now we just figure out what this arrangement looks like, or do we let the kind of exploration we're all suggesting affect that? Or, you know, because abstraction only does it so far, right? We said paint salt, you know, so much rich. It's to, like, you're keeping these old things too, right? There's a reason you're keeping them, because you're fascinated with kind of that tactility, kind of patina, so forth. So I would crank it into the real, basically. I'd start no more abstraction moving forward. I would just make sure everything looks the way it looks in my kind of this ecology you've built. Start to hybridize itself with itself. And just kind of grow as opposed to
first part of the studio, I believe you guys might be great
yeah.
jobs to the research in terms of the site, landscape, and the existing condition. But a couple of thoughts. You know, first of all, when I saw your model, I feel it's in general it's so massive. I think this is maybe rely on, depends on how you approach your design. But first of all, when I look at your site plan, you carefully study the scale. Actually, your scale is, through the site plan point of view, is kind of sensitive and has a strong root and relation with the surrounding. But when we see this angle, actually, it's so massive. This is not, you know, this location, I believe, it is not like a Siena or Verona is kind of a medieval high-density park. Here is not. I believe this is a kind of a suburbia setting. And if you look at the surrounding building, it's never so massive. You know. So I just feel you have to really, this is the reason the study model, especially physical study model, becomes so important for architects. You have to really let yourself be a person to feel, you know, it's not only from the scale. You know, in general, the sense, the relation between the site and, you know, and your design. I think this is the first thing. Secondly, I feel a little bit weak when you work on this project. You have to really start from the tectonic of architecture, like Taliesin White. I believe when the Frank Lloyd arrived, you know, when he started work on this complex, must be really inspired by this natural landscape, materiality, and the idea how he can, you know, make effort to integrate the building with the light, with the orientation, you know, everything, you know, a lot of issues. Then I feel we cannot just work on your design. In the beginning, just think about some knowledge from the, you know, set plan point. Go deeper to think about the architecture, the solution. And then your design probably became to the more realistic and more critical. It's not just a visualization, you know, similarity with the surrounding. Actually, you have to deep root to make the architecture more convincing.
It's okay to be playful. Remember your client is about 10 years old. not
yeah.
some dwarf IBM or that's just arriving, knows exactly what they're building, A75. They want to come there for an experience, not just for one of them, the plaza. So loosen up a little bit and take all the blocks, throw them back on the ground and see what happens. There should be a surprise coming to this project, because that's who your client wants to be surprised. That's what they do a couple hours ago there.
That's great.
Yeah,
right,
great.
Just take all the blocks. Take them up and then you throw them out like really nice, right? And then you just pause it, you know? Because in some ways, like hearing some of the conversations, you're kind of creating a city within a city. And I don't know that's what you want. right? I think you want this more of a kind of destination that kind of contributes to the existing city. So this being this kind of insular insight thing. But I think that's fantastic. You should just take all these blocks and just shake them up and just throw them out and see what happens. Right? It's almost like speed dating. You do it really quick, you know? And then you finally say, okay, I like this one. And then you move on.
There's a precedent I want to throw out there too for everyone working on this project. It's Kino Familia by Moon Hoon. He's a South Korean architect. But again, he worked at his Pinocchio Museum very similarly as a cluster of buildings, but there's a playfulness to it and a sensibility of materiality as well that I think would lend itself to kind of just a good precedent to having a back pocket.
Who was the architect on that?
Moon Hoon.
Moon.
Like Moon, and then Hoon.
Also, I know you're very rigid, and it might be a good opportunity to actually let go and play.
Can you flip that up?
Yeah,
like buy a children.
It doesn't need to happen. It doesn't need to happen.
Here you go.
Your play can end up
being right here.
Genius.
I can buy kids blocks. Like, go to a kid's store and just buy kid blocks and use kid blocks and operate with those kind of things. Just because, again, there's a playfulness just inherent in a physical object.
Go to a schoolyard. I know you're homeschooled, so actually children might do all kinds of weird things in school environments. Go work around the schoolyard.
See what happens.
Work around the schoolyard.
I feel my first house girl was like, well,
Children's library, but more broadly, it's this idea of this sort of fairy tale mecca tourist hub of the world. And so, what's a fairy tale? And the kind of standard dictionary definition of fairy tale is a children's story about magical and imaginary beings and lands. And I got really stuck on that that magical and imaginary land bit and what that could mean to sort of fuel an architecture. As it relates to kids and experiencing this place. And so in that line of thinking and thinking about the magical lands, I just started looking at the context of the site, the landscape, and some of the imagery that was on the competition site and made available to us. And some things that I noticed, which you've seen in some of the photographs up here, and maybe you can see some of the smaller ones up here, but there's a clear domination of green space and vegetation. The hamlet up on the hill is just being swallowed up by dense
This is the villa and the botanical garden, carefully curated, some landscape elements in the past. This is up in the hamlet in the residential areas, which is just lined by these decorative plants. And then this is our site that, as we talked about already, has been sort of neglected. The roof is gone. And so nature has really started to take back over, and it has this ruinous effect that I love. And so the sort of driving concept behind this project for me is trying to use the integration of nature within the architecture as ways of generating surprise, adding to sort of the adventurous wayfinding experience of a kid as he or she goes through this building. And so the kind of quick, dirty rendering up here that I have is just trying to demonstrate this initial move with the library. And so I guess down here we can see this is all library program over here, exhibition space, auditorium, and then this cluster, I'm using all the existing buildings and you know, the idea would be to rehab them and put them back in use. So this would be, let's see, workshop, media space, cafe, and additional exhibition space. But the way that I kind of came up with this was pulling a grid off of this the paper factory that's kind of at a strange angle on this site. And so from there, I guess my partie is sort of this shape that's meant to enclose an interior courtyard and define the space and give it some sort of rhythm by putting a parallel bar that spans across the waterway that runs parallel to the initial paper factory. And so with that grid, I just created these 20 foot by 20 foot bays. And then with that, coming back to this integration of this, you know, sort of spontaneous nature within the system, I'm trying to work on, this is where I'm at now, this is where I'm hoping to get to with the rest of this project, is to kind of have these interchangeable 20 foot by 20 foot pods, for lack of a better term right now. They can change, they can be more open to the elements, like an impluvium where rain can fall inside. They can have a greenhouse top and have a more controlled thermal environment inside. They can just be like view corridors where there's gardens that you just see from within. But to kind of play with and drop these in and around the building in different ways that introduces these elements of surprise. I imagine kids, and I imagine myself as a kid seeing this and just wanting to go zigzag through. And so I guess just switching to just wayfinding, I guess, and how the choreography of this will work. I'm hiding my parking, clearly this is parking, underneath the library program. And so we'll enter, park, and then exit this way. So from the underground parking garage, you come up through a kind of a circular core and a central staircase that takes you up to the main library level. There's also multiple points of pedestrian accessibility, so I want this to just flow if people are walking, with a cafe here that kind of embraces the street. From here, I really swelled these volumes to try and allow myself some wiggle room so I could be really circulation rich inside and allow kids to move around and run and kind of have some freedom of choice in that manner. I guess the exact use of each level is still being worked out, but ultimately as you move higher in the vertical circulation, it gets more loose, more playful, less structured, which then can have sort of worlds within worlds with reading nooks and a lot of different moves that can happen within the sort of larger volumes. And with that, I just hope to start to integrate these, start to develop landscaping. And last thing I'll say is the last project you showed at your lecture last night is one that I'll definitely be looking at, and I would love to get any of your thoughts in particular on this scheme. And so, yeah, if there's any comments or questions.
You know, you said you got, when you looked up the definition of fairy tale, something you said early on in the presentation was you got stuck on this idea of a magical, mystical land, like specifically landscape.
I think that's a good move, and then everyone hides the parking, too. I think that's a, you know, if we're talking magical landscapes, then let's do something with this giant surface program requirement we have in some playful way that as soon as I park in my car, as a kid, I get out, I'm like, this isn't a parking lot. You know, honestly speaking, I think your boxes are definitely a better trajectory, or feel more playful.
Yeah, can you talk about those boxes?
Yeah.
Could I?
Yeah.
Sure, yeah. So within these 20-foot bays, what I'm thinking is, as the program, it's big right now. It's massive. It's kind of overwhelming. So I want to sort of condense and minimize it. And as I do that, and as I develop the plans in more detail, I want to drop these courtyards. So in spaces that I have access to above, another thing I failed to mention is that I do see bringing sort of this ruinous effect into the roofs without getting kind of corny with I don't know, plants draping everywhere. But spaces then to pop outside. When you're inside, you can go outside. You can see outside. You can feel rain and see the sun and have these sort of spontaneous moments of like miniature parks. Like little pocket parks within the 20-foot by 20-foot grid.
I mean, the reason why I asked you is I, out of everything I see, I find those the most fascinating. I don't have children, but I assume I played with this when I was a kid. You guys know the blocks where the kids have the plastic shapes, they have to stick it through into the ball
matching shape.
So like if you look at the cubes, you have the cylinder, you have to push it. I don't know what that's called, but for some reason I think of that. But I'm thinking of children's libraries as kind of toy. And so maybe building off of these comments, like maybe one way of operating the site is you start to deal with, let's say, primitive geometry, mm-hmm. like triangles, circles, and squares, which I'm starting to see on these perfect, right? And it becomes a game about, let's say, composition within the frame. Right? It has nothing to do with building, it has nothing to do with program, it just has to do with you designing, right? Just you adapting to the site. And for some reason, I'm looking at these little boxes, right, these little characteristics, and it's like, maybe that's the project, just mm-hmm. for like a week or two exercise. We forget about the program, forget about the site, you work on shapes within the frame, right? And how you start to understand figuration, layering, graphics, right? And it might be a productive tool, I think, to get beyond, let's say, the building, right? To really embrace the kind of rule set. But for me, I think there's something special about those little artifacts.
Maybe a different approach. I like the idea, maybe a slightly different approach is to actually work with the building elements, but build from the context and build from this idea of it being a kind of magical land. So what you could do is maybe identify some medieval tropes, a tower, the effluvium, which represents the ancient Roman, but kind of assemble a series of magical spaces, building from the context and different tropes, and see if you can assemble those. You gotta be very careful with that, and see how they feel very accurate.
Yeah.
That might be another way if you're more drawn to getting into the building right away. Maybe there's a way to work with building elements to start to assemble your scheme. But the abstract shapes would also be another way. But I can see how something like that would be very playful if you're thinking about a tower element and then another type of spatial element kind of combined together. You might get some kind of interesting. And then your plan and your kind of massing is more like a space planning exercise, and it is like a convincing kind of part key, as you probably know. Although when I look at that plan, the top right, I certainly think of the Villa Busk by Sverre Fenn, and I think it's very much this kind of assembly of classic trope building elements. It's like a bridge building. It's almost like a medieval castle. It's a very thin volume. That's a residential scale. It's an intimate scale. So how would it scale up to this type of program? I'm not really sure. But that might be something interesting to look at. I mean, you could have a turret. You could have an arcaded space. So it could kind of become castle-like and magical in that way.
Section. Just, I would explore the project in section for like a couple weeks at least. Like only that. Don't even look at your plans. Because I think the words you were using to describe this, it's like, even your rendering, you're like, when I see this, I just want to run up it.
that's a sectional drawing, mm-hmm. right? You were saying, and this is where you like zigzag through there and up and over the space and outside, and those are all sectional. Because I think, you know, this kind of perimeter frame that you're doing, if you think of that as a kind of unrolled path that you experience, that's a very different understanding of what your project is, instead of just kind of like describing it through these plans, right? Because I think that's what you're talking about, is the fact that, you know, you come in and you start around here, but you want to go around this, right? So you know where you start, you see where you want to end, and you want to sprint as fast as you can up through this thing, around here, and down, right? And that's, you know, that's the kind of energy of a child, of a kind of, you know, really claiming the space and, you know, running away from your parents, but still being within their eyesight. They're like, oh yeah, they're over, you know, in the other bar. Like, that's when it's a narrative, right? Yeah, but I think the frame, I mean, also with that, invert your building right now, just make it a white frame, and like your guys' precedents or your research, like, the ones that the context is white and the site is colorful,
uh-huh.
like switch and think in that way, because that's super successful, especially for what you're describing,
okay.
that you're capturing this moment with the river and the outdoor fields and the, you know, all of these can be expressed in color, you know, zoom in on that.
Yeah, play with color and also introduce paper too, it's a surface element. I mean, you can imagine 20 years of posters layered deteriorating and stripped away, and all the sort of texture and color to reflect on the history of the place.
Which is what, you know, very interesting things that was mentioned. My project gave you some inspiration, but actually, I've been inspired by your thinking. I feel you can concentrate your energy and idea to develop the bridge type of architecture. I think this is a lot of fun for the kids. For example, you know, kids like to play the river bank, you know, like a, you know, small animal. You know, they like to go up and down to concentrate like a turtle. Or so as long as you focus on the bridge, actually you can provide you a lot of thought to let children play. To think about the structure. I mean, it's not things that your design currently is not like a long span, right? More like a very stable column frame, you know, like the gravity distributed equally, but actually the bridge is a long span. You need to think about spatial architecture instead of normal, you know, column beam idea in order to create, you know, a lot of interesting spatial, the character like his to go up, down, play the river, landscape. This is what I'm
hearing. You have a dog, so.
Yeah, you have a dog.
If you were to pull into the parking lot and let your dog out of the car, where's the dog going to go? It's going to race down to the bank to explore the water. And then where most people initially want to see and explore, and perhaps could actually move from the bank up to the building and make the building interesting enough with color or form and form to draw people up into that.
You also need to manipulate the landscape. The landscape can come up into the building, mm-hmm. so that play can happen in the landscape too. That's fair game.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think the bridge is an opportunity too to start playing with water in some way. How do we introduce or like bring in that system that maybe, you know, I think that early project I was looking around where they just made the drain in the middle of the plaza. There was an existing underground river that was running through there, and all they did was make a hole so you could hear it. Essentially, and even pumping the water up in some playful way for children to play with as an experience with, you know.
Like a waterfall coming down from the bridge.
Yeah.
Think about a falling water. Oh, they have something there. Actually, you are the, you know, most important, you know, inspiration place on architecture. I have been the artist at Anson Giffer's studio in South France. He created some interesting for his young kids. You know, he used a lot of the like industrial, like chimney, internal. He just lay down the chimney, you know, on the landscape. Kids like play sometimes when you climb up. So I feel it's a lot of possibility. One, especially for your side, since I like your idea, take advantage of the river, build some bridge, you know, can be your more danger, you know, more interesting.
And also zoom out, you know, the last project was all about how it sits as a massing in relationship to the city. Mm. Your project, you didn't talk about the city like at all, which I really appreciate. Talking towards what you're doing strategically is creating this other space. But I still think that, you know, step back and see, well, what am I providing for the city? Like, is it that I am a bridge that is fully public at all times? Like, is there some layer of this that becomes, you know, a gift to the city in some other way? So.
I really want to switch my ear and my nipple. Bear with me. I had this idea for an artwork, and I want to switch my ear and my nipple. How do I do that? I have to find a doctor who's going to do it, right?
That'd be a good idea.
Why would it be hard to find a doctor to do it?
No one does it.
No one would do it. Why not? I mean, it's great. It would be a really cool piece, right?
I don't know why anyone would want to do it other than you for an effort.
Right. So when you've opened up this amazing box when you say, I Skyped with this kid, and I'm going to take what they're saying and turn it into a building. Because the ultimately, the onus is on you to make the building. And I just want to bring this up because there's an artist, by the way, who searched for a long time to find somebody who, it was actually grafting an ear onto his shoulder or something. And he eventually had to go like to some foreign country and get it done, and then I think he died, he had his like arm cut. Anyway, the lesson being, just be wary of this relationship with, and this is for everybody, for dealing with client input in certain ways. I don't think you did anything wrong here, but that's a very interesting line and thread of where we allow inputs and where we as architects in charge of health, safety, and welfare have to say, I'm going to take children's parks and place them and see what the research is on how to keep kids safe and what, you know, what a kid's going to want, we can imagine, isn't realistic or isn't, maybe it wouldn't mesh really well with the overall design. So I think you could really investigate that edge difference between sort of this input level and how you're creating that with sort of out them knowing. Because it's your job to make a child want to tell those stories or want to create those instances. Not necessarily ask them what they want and make the thing, but ask them what inspires them, how they project and create those stories without them being right in front of them. They have to engage with stuff and use their imagination, right? And so it's not always a direct translation. Even though I love the idea, to me, I see a lot of your hand in this. So maybe think about that input and ways in which you can make that happen without anybody programming.
And just to be clear, it's my nephew that's asking for the ear switch.
Yeah, right. You're the doctor. Right. You're the dentist. Somebody wants a USB tooth.
So what?
I'm an activist
researcher.
You're not going to share with us.
Well, he just gave me a list, and it's hilarious. I actually don't have it. I could go get it, but it would send us down a different.
Because I appreciate Ryan's comments, and I think it's totally valid to really think about this, though it's going to be built.
Yeah.
But I also would encourage you too to really take this time as an opportunity to learn about yourself.
Yeah.
Like maybe this isn't going to get built. Right? This is just an aspiration of learning. Maybe one day we have the opportunity to build, and it really it's about operating way of working or really creating a body of work while you're here. And so for me, it's still building. Like, it's too building too quick. You know, there's like mullions or columns and glass. And, you know, the previous project, it was mostly just massing. And I would really encourage you to figure out kind of rule set of decision making. And if that's, you know, looking at, let's say, children's books, like, how does a book go together? Right? The kind of architecture of a book, the graphics, and maybe you can steal something from that. Or maybe there's something in your past, or maybe there's something from your nephew that you can take. It will help you develop a kind of way of operating for yourself. Right? And it's not just about, let's say, clients and codes and budget, but it's really about you, right? And how you operate on the site. But I really wish we had that stuff from your nephew. I'm like super curious now.
Go get it.
You'll share it.
Okay. We'll share it.
All right, we should probably move.
Yeah.
Thank you guys.
Briefly by just talking about the general context, which I'm responding to, hopefully quite critically. I'm Jan, I'm a second year student. So the general context is Carlo Colli wrote The Adventures of Pinocchio during the Edification, the end of the 19th century, and this was a time of tumultuous change in Italy. But there was still this idea that knowledge could be ascertained from an authoritative source, and knowledge could be given to children through their authority, who were the parents, and there was this relationship between the parents and the child. And therefore, you know, Pinocchio undergoes this transformation after a number of firstly, I start to think about this phenomenological approach, this experiential approach, that Christian Oakley Schultz talks about, this idea that the Italian village comes directly out of the landscape, and these campaniles, these tall towers, and these sort of centralizing elements arise just kind of naturally from the landscape. Then I kind of got tired of that eventually. I played around with these massings. I thought there were a lot of interesting experiences, but I just wanted to play more and push that further. And so then I went somewhere where a lot of people didn't go, so I looked into postmodernism, this kind of symbolic contextual approach to the site. So I thought of maybe introducing a water element, maybe introducing an aqueduct or some kind of other Roman or Italian element. This is an Italian project. It is a project that is sponsored by the Italian government, so I think it's a nation-building cultural project, and so that's why I took this approach. The next one is I started looking at this idea of screens and these patterns developed by Gio Ponti, an Italian architect, just to sort of idiosyncratically try to approach this and maybe pry something out. I wasn't quite sure what I was going to discover, but I thought that these niches kind of create these envelopes and these places for children where they could hide and perhaps investigate something, maybe open their iPad or something. It was just another investigation. And then the fourth investigation, I thought about the different axial relationships to the Hamlet and to this kind of approach of this theatrical, the creating an architecture through a theater and through these ramps where one would walk up and things would open up to you in a particular avenue. So walking from Pinocchio Park up a slowly sloping ramp and then having the library opening up to the views on either side of the river. So that was another approach that I took. But then I started to realize that all of these buildings were fundamentally flawed in that we don't store knowledge in dusty books like we used to. What knowledge really comes down to is about how we curate the things in our life, the, like, And so my project is called the Matryoshka Hive. Matryoshka is a Russian nesting doll. And so I'm thinking about this hive where people could enter and curate their own experience. I want people to learn to curate their both their space and their themselves. I think that's the thing that we've learned from Pinocchio, is that through a journey, he goes through a number of missteps, but hopefully we don't have to do that if people learn to curate their own space and curate their own knowledge. So I essentially create this hive, this giant 10-story sphere within which one would enter, and then my future investigations will delve more into materiality, and I'm reading two books on developmental psychology and how I could have, I'm not sure what kind of material I'm going to fill with, whether it's going to be small or big, whether it's going to be gooey, squishy, or whatever, but I want it to be about people being able to remove, subtract from a structure, and being able to build sort of these small nests for themselves, and being able to curate their own knowledge, bring their own knowledge from the outside, and hopefully emerge, with some kind of ability to organize and curate their own lives better. So the question you might be asking, why did I choose a sphere? A sphere sort of was this natural idea that a sphere would sort of naturally kind of gather, because the site itself is gathering. It's at the center of this valley, and that's exactly where that ball just landed. That's where my building's going to go. So that's my project.
The ball is the proper scale for the volume of the quarry.
No, it's bouncy, so it's easy to roll down. It's
considerably larger.
It's about this big. It's about the size of London.
Also, if we're going to go with this ball thing, and it accumulates and so forth, it's kind of like a snowball, necessarily, at that point, right? I take that quite in. There's a big difference between that ball, or that thing in the sphere, and that's where I'm looking at these beautiful studies you did before, and then all of a sudden you distilled it down into a sphere.
Well, I think it's more than just a sphere. It's a hive. It's this idea that the density increases as you move in.
Yeah, but then you put it in a neat little geodesic sphere. Like, it's neat. It's tuning. And what I'm getting at with this...
I just don't look like that.
No. I think that this is something that I have to produce quickly and put it on a board. It's not what my sphere is actually going to look like.
But that's what I'm getting at with the point of either the gum, like the thing of tape, or mm-hmm. a thing of gum, or a thing of snowball. It's not a sphere. It's this lumpy, imperfect... accumulated, gets dirty, gets gross things on it, and so forth. And that would be, if you wanted to go that direction, I still think the sphere, at least conceptually speaking, of this idea of cumulative knowledge through like curation and everyone brings their own thing to the table, I still don't think that ultimately belongs or deserves to be in a sphere of any sort. But if you were to take the sphere thing forward, then take it quite literally and look at those things that would actually physically accumulate if you roll them down somewhere. And that might give you a cue of what that is, that might look like.
But maybe it's different, like you can perceive this in different ways, right? So if we talk about the sphere, it's a drawing, right? It's a circle, there's no start, there's no finish. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like knowledge in some ways. So if you look at the drawings, right, they're much different than if we were to actually make a model, mm-hmm. right? There's two different worlds, let's say the model versus the drawing. And so maybe that's where the project wants to be. It has nothing to do other than that. It's just this conversation about speculative of what the possibilities of understanding is kind of sphere, and then understanding that through drawings, through sections and plans and geometry, right, and how you can start to take these kind of studies, which I actually find the studies very useful, right, just to help you make decisions when you start to go into details. For instance, the one on the left could be a city, the size of a city, the one in the middle could be as small as your foot, the ones, or something that's parking structure. You put scale to these things and it can become a different application. But I have a feeling like you're just going to do your thing, and I think you should do it. Right? If this is what you want to do, you should do it. But you really have to understand its relationship in a kind of architectural context. And I think as architects, we use tools such as plan and section and elevation and models to understand our work. Right? And so maybe that's where the project wants to live. Maybe that's what you have to kind of focus on for the rest of the semester.
there's an Italian philosopher, Giacomo Bassano or something. He did Weak Thought, and out of that came this whole thing about weak form that Peter Eisen kind of tried to do at some point in time. But that's a pretty interesting state on knowledge and how we accumulate that as well. And yeah, and again, you seem pretty versed in your reading about this topic, so I would definitely, you know, look into that avenue potentially. And again, to Ryan's point then, you know, it's the misinterpretation. There's like an autonomy to each piece, right? You work on plan, but it's kind of its own world, and you're working on plan, and you work on model, and that's kind of its own thing. And then, like, the magic is, or the surprise of the whole process is when you have to, like, oh shit, these things don't match. And then that's kind of the moment that it happens.
Yeah.
And that's kind of how I think maybe, you know, at least hearing how you're discussing the idea of knowledge, that's how it kind of accrues itself.
When I think about knowledge, and I always feel like when I was in school, or when I'm interested in a topic, it's more of a kind of devouring of information. Like you get excited about one aspect, and you know, find 30 books on that aspect of something, and that leads you off into, you know, spaces you wouldn't have thought about in the beginning.
I would say that, just to counter a little bit, wouldn't you say that knowledge or the quick access to information can become a distraction if one doesn't cultivate a certain curatorship in one's life?
True. Right? Yeah. No. But I think those kind of clues on where you could branches you might shoot off on are always there. But it's your internal focus to, you know, stay on track. But what I'm trying to get at is that the I don't know if this is the original tale, but like when I think Pinocchio, I think of that whale that just devours everything, and there's this whole society inside, or whatever, there's just stuff. There's all this stuff that lives in this new world that's kind of, it's nondescript, you don't know where it starts or it stops, you know. And just thinking like volumetrically, like there's something to that, that there, it's a shapeless thing, and it goes back to like, is it a ball of gum, is it whatever, but you know, how I would just explore that with modeling methods. Like, what are the forms of accumulation? Like, is it a sausage that you like squirt things into? Like, is it a tree that starts at one point and then branches? Is it a sphere that, you know, you stick things to? Like, there's so many ways that you can accumulate and grow.
No, I think that's a great question. I'm not hardcore into the sphere.
Sure.
It's just a quick grasshopper script that I could run.
Yeah, it's very different if you're thinking of it as a sphere versus a hive. You've got to figure out what game you want to play. So is it accumulation of parts? Is it a land form? Is it postmodern game? So you kind of have to determine kind of what game you want to play. And it is important that is it accumulation of cells, or is it kind of fitting things into this iconic form? I wanted to actually talk about the Pinocchio scheme. That I felt like someone should say that definitely looks as a Pinocchio as a no scheme. And I think that I think that could be really a fun project, and you know, could you somehow avoid some of the traps of pursuing that like as a literal kind of facial representation of Pinocchio and still develop an interesting scheme? Actually, the collage is kind of interesting as an aqueduct with this more abstract space on top. Maybe you could have like Pinocchio's nose, and then like the hive is actually the whale that's accumulating, so giving kind of elements kind of speaking to one another. But why not be like really playful and fun for a children's library? There could be a way to to make it more kind of serious and critical when you kind of collage elements together. But why not start with these like
so
poetic ideas?
Yeah, to that like. The image of an aqueduct, you said, like, maybe it'll do something in the water. I kind of like that if you're going this approach and it's just the image of an aqueduct, then it's alive, right? It's not actually surfacing water, which connects you to Pinocchio's nose, which is...
That's interesting.
But
that's a connection you made, right?
I didn't even think of that as... Yeah,
it's
a
John
Pinocchio's nose.
It's John Pinocchio's.
Those are connections you're making, which is fun.
It's like super John Pinocchio's.
Right.
But then in some of Cease's projects, he's got representations of the face and the facade of the building.
Right.
It's interesting things with your reading and psychology and conceiving of this as a stimulating place for children.
Cool.
But we're making those connections about your study models.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Not the spirit.
Yeah. Didn't you say it's going to be soft and squishy or something?
Is it going to make it soft and squishy? Or
a suggestion.
Yeah.
So the sphere is going to be...
I was really...
Do you know Katamari Damacy?
No, but...
Yeah.
Soft and squishy is where I'm headed.
Oh, no, that's what you did. That's what you should have done.
Yeah.
If that's what you're interested in...
That's what I'm interested in.
There's a PlayStation game that's at the MoMA. Like, it's an unbelievable game where you start as a small object, and you run into other objects, and you try to get bigger, and you gain mass. And so when you win, and by the time you win, you're just this accumulated glob rolling down the street. Unbelievable game. Beautiful. Play it.
What's it called?
Katamari Damacy.
Then maybe if you go down that path, like,
I'm probably
building building
K A T A M A R I.
Right. So you can have a normal thing in the project, and it's about
D A M A C
on the possibilities of the project in some ways.
Stickiness.
And stickiness or parts or whatever it is. And we should be able to respect it. It's just like this obsessive of just aggregating these things in this kind of weird added way. Instead of trying to figure out, you know, a very particular thing, it's just a kind of result of the process. I think that would be more fascinating than trying to really turn this into, let's say, a library. Maybe that's against the rules, but in some ways, maybe the rules, you know, this idea of kind of disciplinary misbehavior is sometimes appropriate for projects. And maybe this is one of them, right, and how you can start to operate in that context.
Well, that's what I'm interested in.
If you can make a wall section of all from that, I am all for it.
Okay. Yeah, messy to a wall section.
Yeah. It can be squishy. Mm-hmm. Good luck with that.
Sky when you're a kid and you're sort of experiencing the world in a completely different way. So just seeing that footage play in the morning, it just gets me a certain mindset of what it's.
Yeah.
There's
one more thing that we kind of skipped over, but it was like bouncing it to begin with, mm-hmm. the ball, which is an idea that translates into a building form, possibly, that is very different from the kind of static object, that maybe it is something that does, like a child, like the game of lava, like don't step on the cracks or don't step in the lava, but the idea that you have through the city is a very different concept, and it's kind of one you almost started with, that you're like, the ball's here, and then it's here, and then it's here. Like that's, I would explore that too, to see what a decentralized library is, something that moves around, or something that, you know, makes you explore, literally, through the city.
Well, if I could
if your sphere is sitting in that riverbed, what happens when a ball sits in a creek and rotates and moves? Why not have an exterior skin that is free of the interior, so you have a skin that's constantly moving with a contained interior?
I had some movable parts before in some of these iterations. Aaron called them cute.
You'll see the
that's fine.
80s horror movie Critters.
Critters start accumulating.
It was mentioned a pejorative way.
Sphere, this giant squishy sphere of
disobey.
Units. One last comment.
It's need to kill your
one last comment too. I mean, this is just an overarching, like, figure out what conversation you want to have too, because you talk a lot about the physical, like, conceptual avenue and the idea of knowledge and so forth, and if that's the case, I really do
necessarily just going into architecture, at least, you know, it will ultimately in the studio, right? Have to. So it will, but operate in that fashion if that's the conversation you want to have, as opposed to trying to, you know, force a representation that doesn't cater itself to that conversation. So just something to think about.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's just do it all at once, I guess?
So, reading Pinocchio and learning about the story, the thing that I grasped onto was the piece of wood, and the way that the story starts is kind of the typical fairy tale. There was once upon a time, and then as a sort of like humorous additive, Carlo Collodi says, my readers will probably say, a king or a magician, and he says, no, it's a piece of wood. There was once upon a time a piece of wood, and it's kind of like a letdown for the kids, which is kind of funny. And he talks about how it was just an ordinary piece of wood. Master Cherry is the initial character who has this piece of wood, and he was going to build a leg for a table out of it, but then as he was about to cut it, the wood screamed, and he was kind of scared by that, so he gave it away to Geppetto, who then ended up carving the wood into Pinocchio. So when I was thinking about the piece of wood initially, the idea that I had a piece of wood similar to this, and it had little sort of stubs branching out of it. And I was looking at wood as a material, sort of branching and knots and grain, and I was using that to kind of determine the way that I decided to go about putting my buildings on the site. So this is my original scheme here. And what I did basically was I took the paper factory and then I sort of branched off of it and had the large central library building and then had the other programs branching off of that main building. And the more I thought about it, what's unique about the piece of wood in the story of Pinocchio isn't the fact that it has a wood-like characteristic. It's not the branching aspect, it's not the knots, and it's not the grain. It's the act of carving and sort of the revealing what's in the piece of wood that's so remarkable, because, as I said, it's described as just an ordinary piece of wood, but then what's discovered through carving it is Pinocchio, and which goes on throughout the rest of the story and ultimately becomes a real person. So I just recently kind of abandoned the branching idea and the knots, and I was using knots as the program elements within the block of wood, grain being circulation, and that started to seem a little too literal and a little, I don't know, I didn't want to kind of beat the wood metaphor to death, so I ended up going toward carving, and so what I've done now is kind of created a block of wood or a piece of wood that's the library, and the other program elements are carved out of it, and so what you have is, in this model, it's not entirely accurate because they're represented as voids, but in actuality, I imagine that the building is essentially a solid piece, and the other programs like the auditorium, the media space, the workshop, reading rooms, and those sort of things are actually carved into the block of wood. And so that's actually represented on the exterior itself. You see those carves out of the block of wood, but also on the interior of the building, it manifests in materiality. So the experiential quality of the building is that going into it, you feel like you've entered a piece of wood, and you go into the rooms and you feel like it's been carved out of this piece of wood. So this is a new development now, and just exploring the idea of carving. And I had actually done this concept model before I thought about carving, when I was still thinking about branching. But in discussions about kind of distilling the idea down to kind of one word or two words. Those ended up being would and rather than additive subtractive. So it's the idea of taking something like a block of wood, a piece of wood, and then seeing what can come out of it by literally carving into it and giving the impression that by carving into a piece of wood, you can reveal what's already in there and kind of, in a sense, the user kind of feels that quality of it's being, they're being discovered what's inside of the library. And then making it one sort of massive building rather than splitting it up and fragmenting it. In my original scheme, I was thinking of kind of going with the language of the existing paper factory. It's this kind of long linear building with these ancillary buildings that are perpendicular and branching off of it. So I wanted to continue that and mimic some other instances where we see that throughout the town of Collodi. But then going with this block of wood, it has much more of a presence, especially when you think about kind of on the streetscape as a facade. It continues where there's a sort of a gap in the streetscape. It becomes this sort of like, I guess this like really kind of monumental piece of architecture within the town. And I imagined it being kind of referred to as the piece of wood or seen as the piece of wood. It's sort of visible from all angles of the town. Yeah, so I'd like to open it up for any questions or comments. And for the most part, I kept it consistent with how these programs were carved out. I was thinking about what dictates the shape. These sort of filleted squares are mostly just derived from carving. It's more of like a scooping sort of action rather than like a kind of like a rectilinear chiseling. And then something like the auditorium is like the actual function of it's expressed more in the way that that's carved out.
This idea is going to be very interesting. And in the beginning you mentioned you're going to use the spirit of the covering, right? But my question why your beauty is so, your last piece model is used like a folding character instead of carving solid. Mm-hmm. Actually, you can imagine if that piece of wood model is solid, it just carve off a lot of interesting detail or, you know, like a scene, transfiguring, whatever. It's going to be much more consistent, your idea. I feel this one somehow to turn your idea into this like a folding skin idea. In another point of view, you know, if you try to make this fit your side, right? So your form cannot be so much object. You know, right now you're too perfect. Like a square, and another moment, you're also touched with your existing architecture. I think a two way. Once you try to make an object, you have to make your beauty right like this. More intense is like an object, and also somehow to far away from existing condition to create a kind of an object, an atmosphere. Once you try to integrate with the surrounding, you look at the surrounding, it's kind of where vision in terms of whatever surrounding and then your building. Maybe for example, you can cut out one piece to show, or more like your section, the solid model to show you how you carve off.
I felt like, unfortunately, that model doesn't actually tell what the truth is. It should be solid, and these are pockets essentially that are carved out, whereas it just communicates like a facade or just voids.
Yeah. Are you using resin?
Yeah.
It's your first year?
Second year.
So like what I would do as a recommendation is like forget about everything and just think about carving. Forget about the building, forget about wood. Just go inside Rhino and make a cube and then boolean away using, let's say, spheres until you no longer have a cube. Right? really just carving shape, and you're thinking about shape, and you're understanding its relationship to how you're talking about it. I think it's actually a really beautiful project, talking about wood. But I think, just the comments before, it's not doing what you're saying, right? And I think this idea of using the computer as a tool to help you understand or kind of visualize that aspiration, I think is really important. And it's just the kind of a process of steps, right? It's pulling out one object until you no longer see that object. You think about like an old, like back in the day when they made statues, right? So just kind of hammering away at some kind of giant mass, and then over time it starts to create a kind of gesture or behavior or a thing. And so in some ways I think like this one, Keith, is a little bit more satisfying than this. Another thing that I would recommend, if you are going to do the wood thing, you have to be very careful how you make these. So like, I would really want the grain of the wood to go this way, right? When you make basswood models or anything, it's always, there's a direction to the grain of the wood. And I think it's that relationship between the kind of aspiration of the wood and also the physical objects that you make that creates a project. So like laser cutting this thing, I don't know if it's showing it justice.
I don't think it is. And I wanted to actually use the domino and like a piece of wood.
You just domino chop here, right?
Yeah.
You can just start to cut away.
Yeah.
You know? But I think it's a beautiful project. Just it'd be good for you to work formally on what cutting and carving actually means.
Suggestion with Brian to do one. I also like the talks modeling is great. It's really smooth. It's more playful. Rhino kind of may ask versus kind of more painterly kind of tweaking the form of carving, like more actually carving the shape. And just well, it's not so subtle point, but you know, if this is going to be an object building or a massive entity, I think you need to divorce it from the existing structure. I think you need to pull it away. And you got to keep that structure and be wise to program it or consider how it relates, but I think you need to separate and create the gap between it, because it looks like the drone is like touching, butting up right against it. I think that's probably the wrong move. There's definitely need to work on the relationship between it. The tension between it versus it being subservient to it. Yeah, you can go vertical too. Totally, yeah.
I wonder too, like, how many steps of revealing something's like identities you can perform. Like, the carving away is a subtractive element to it, but then when you end up with this object that is the result of subtraction, how can you use an object to then create another object? Like, is it used as a way to mold concrete formwork? Can you actually get a positive made, you know, get the negative made from the positive made from the negative? And then you start to play out like ideas of making, like of creating identity that's not so obvious, right? Like when you look at a piece of wood that has no carving yet, it's full of possibilities. So I wonder how you can keep that ambiguity of not knowing what it is while knowing what it is. Do you know what I mean? Like, the experience of the library might be this discovered thing that you kind of always knew was there, but you're experiencing it differently. Does that make sense? I think just like push this like another couple steps of making and see if that leads you somewhere. And it, of course, with the Boolean exercises too, right? Like figuring out, I don't think it's filleted rectangles like 100% of the time. Like, what does that mean if it's not? You know, do you carve something? I don't think you're going to make the same thing every time.
Yeah.
If this came early on, this carved model.
Yeah, that was before, when I was still thinking about it as a piece of wood, not grain, scratching. But I was still thinking about it. What's being revealed?
It's a valid method to, like, using it to make a craft concept of material, right? The challenge is then to, like, translate that into architecture. You were doing that with
how well does this translate into the architecture, and what you might learn from that, that act of translation? Because this is kind of giving you constraints, right? Giving you a direction. It's starting to give you a tactile sense, or even an atmospheric sense of what the building might be. Then kind of adapting the program and all that, it's a challenge. But it's a valid method, it's a practice.
I suggest you to study some, you know, like the Chinese garden, and go back to a couple hundred years ago, like Chinese scholars, they applied for a very special type of stone. Maybe since you know, currently we under construction building, we just cut the stone. Actually, the inside had a lot of organic kind of the cave, you know, when you cut, actually interesting the way it's worth it, your approach, you can study about this kind of stone. It's very interesting. Xinxuan, if you can help to find some image.
I think, you know, I have three comments probably here, and the first is take stock in your ugly experiments, right? I mean, we're obviously all gravitating to this as an object and as a kind of formal thing and so forth. So I just don't discredit that in anybody's project or so forth. Anything you do, think of it as a kind of a cumulative process rather than step one, step two, step three kind of attitude. I think it's interesting that you had suggested going digital space to carve, when really, you know, digital space is going to give you exactly what we have here, which is like character and figure and so forth. But then physically doing it, we're getting more a posture and object, right? So I think you should actually be working between the two. You should try to model that in Rhino through carving techniques and digital space, and then retry to carve the new model in Rhino, the physical object, and then look at this new physical, and it will change constantly as it keeps moving through, and that might be a way to kind of get both qualities of these, because as soon as you turn that up, there's a figure to that, it's kind of a character which speaks to Pinocchio and so forth, but this one has a really kind of exquisite posture, it's kind of sloppy, it's, you know, kind of trudging through the forest.
And what's beautiful about that, or what's interesting is that the skin, the bark is what's extraordinary about that. You wonder certain things about that, which you lost in the process. Also, the end grain, which is really amazing to play with the beautiful circular growth patterns of that piece of wood. You can also try to think like a termite for a while. What's a termite go for?
You're a termite.
40-hour out. You know, 40 kids get off a bus, and they're told, you're a termite. And the termites get on that site. What are those termites going to do?
Or imagine this hypothetical, like if this was a formwork and we poured like something into this whole city and then carved it. Or figure out how this thing works at a different scale too, instead of thinking of, well, I got, you know, either a log or a box of a certain scale and I have to like tilt that somewhere to fit on the site. Think of it like, what if the whole city was this material and you had it removed? Like, how do you get the city and your project? You know what I mean? Like, how can it be that you can read the city as, you know, as this accumulation that was talked about in the last project, that it's born of the place? Like, maybe that's a way to think, too, that this city itself is this kind of thing that you're carving out.
This is the last conversation. If we're talking about the form of this thing, right, it's very organic. Obviously, it comes from nature. It's not man-made, versus, let's say, something like shape. So this is a rectangle. And so maybe the project wants to operate between both. And I think this is part of the conversations around how you figure out the technique. Like, is the whole thing still, like, you know, kind of falling over a tree? Or is there something a little bit more, let's say, synthetic in how you're operating? Maybe doing the program, or the site, or, you know, the part here, whatever it is. Maybe that's this kind of relation between, let's say, clear kind of surfaces versus very organic, you know, texture. That's kind of where the project wants to go, at least for me, I think. So I would encourage you to look at this as a kind of study, you know, characteristics of it as kind of both.
And again, keyword there, characteristics. It's not the metaphor of the work, it is the quality of the building that you're after, not the metaphor.
Connor, I'll show you how to make an unbelievable 3D scan of that. plop it right in your eye now.
I just printed out these. I had to make those shapes, and I printed them out larger and got a piece of wood and tried to carve what that shape would be. And then I was thinking that it'd be interesting to then make that the actual fate, because it's not perfect and has a bit of a, but then the other thing about these shapes is they're sort of arbitrary, and is it okay to have these carved shapes that are just sculptural and arbitrary, or do they want to, like, the amphitheater express more what's actually happening?
So yeah, you'll have to define that for yourself.
Okay, I think that's good for that. Appreciate it. You've got a small studio. There's only 7, so there's 3 more. And we have, like, military precision. We have lunch exactly at 12:30. So, and we have the 3 schemes that are left are quite different. Okay. I might have a recommendation. Maybe we give 10 minutes to each, let each of them present in unison instead of responding individually. And then either feedback over lunch, extend into lunch, come back, wrap at that time. Does that seem to make sense? You guys can juggle the variables. You will get absolutely plenty of feedback. Let's get off in the wall.
Yeah, and that's what I'd like you to try to get right.
Second decision is to design architectural language of folk, and this folk will be the facade, the structure, and the interior partition, and which is what I learned from structure class of simple pose and beam. I'll talk about this more. The third decision is to expose the mechanical system on ceiling and floors, just like in the whale stomach. And analogy comes from Pinocchio's story, because the transformation of Pinocchio is after all the destruction away from the school, he ended up jumping off the cliff and went into the water in the ocean, and then went to this whale's, big whale's stomach and saved his father. And that's how he transformed and became a real boy. And this library, this whole program is about transformation of children, about growth. So I think it's appropriate to make this building itself the metaphor of the well and expose the organ of the building. So that's the three decisions I made. So as you can see, I spent some time in the 3D modeling, and this structure is going to be the major thing that I'm going to study, and there are some plans here that has the structural grid. It's very hard to explain, but it's all mathematics. So Le Corbusier's modular is mathematic. It's a grid itself. And the grid is scalable. It's furniture. it becomes a phenomenological experience of a room once the room is thicker and thinner. So right now, I'm not doing the XYZ group thing for the interior. But this is like a cafe. Well, the cafe is streamlined using very thin, that's like 0.1 meter in this rendering. Not in the rendering, but that's my first attempt. And what I'm trying to do for next 8 weeks is to, I can talk to Sean and Ruan a bit about what I'm going to do in the 6 and 8 months, which is this, not even, but design a structural mist. And Sean has been very generous and, you know, letting me do my own thing. And I'm trying to propose to Aaron, not Aaron, Sean, Ruan about it as well, so I can get an understanding of how construction works, so I can actually get this thing built. And then incorporate this concept into the construction and structure, which fits in our studio, the integrated design studio. So that's what I want to do at the next game on. Third is my process. So I left a lot of things untitled in each rendering and the entire model, and a lot of joints, and there was a point that my computer did not work. So I had to work for 2 weeks on paper. It was incredibly difficult for a project like this. And this process of studying with something complex and just subject it has been very challenging to me because I don't have enough speed to catch up with my thought. I research so much, my concept jumps so much, but my physical representation never catch up. And that has been very frustrating. Since the beginning, that jump into any design studio. And I'm open to like ideas of how I can do it better, you know. Matthew is telling me that I should start with something simple, and then layering up. I'm gonna try that. But we'll see. So at the end.
So questions or clarification first? Anything for right now, or you think you have the general theme of it?
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's move on to Richard then. Thanks.
Okay. Sort of the overall one, but you can have that. This is sort of just the process. My name's Richard. So I don't think Pinocchio is a children's story at all. I think it's a story for adults. And I'm going to explain what I mean by that, but basically the realization that I've come to is we live in a highly inframed world, and what I mean by that is absolutely everything can be transformed into a commodity. Even the Northern Lights can be turned into a commodity, something as weird as that. So, I mean, August is doing a project on a tourist resort in Scandinavia, so people can go up there and experience the Northern Lights. And they're doing basically the same thing to Pinocchio, right? They're commodifying the story of Pinocchio. They're turning this into a tourist hub. So, I sort of took that as my starting point. This idea that everything can be turned into a commodity, right? And so for my precedent study, which you can see in there, I did an Amazon Fulfillment Center. And so these things basically are storehouses of culture. It's like the modern day Library of Alexandria. Everything goes in there, and then we live in this world now where technology can allow you to order something on your phone, and then it just magically appears at your door 2 days later. And the process that happens to, in order for that to take place, is very mysterious. And so one of the reasons for that occurring is these sophisticated machines, these sophisticated computers that can sort of process all that data and send all that information and pass it around and get that thing delivered. And so that's just one example. I mean, this you could you can make the case for anything. I mean, we're all being commodified right now because we're in school, and the idea is hopefully when we graduate, we're economically more valuable than when we went in. Hopefully. So I'm playing with this idea, right, that everything is being sort of transformed into standing reserve. And this relates to Pinocchio directly because, and this is why I say Pinocchio is an adult story, because we're all starting out as free subjects moving to commodified objects, but Pinocchio is going in reverse. He starts out as a commodity, he's a toy. And his whole journey is just, he wants to become a boy. He wants to go back to being a boy and move himself from all this, right? So there's that whole thing going on. And then it sort of made me realize that there's two sort of realms here. There's sort of a human realm and a machine realm, because all that data processing and all those things that happen require their own sort of environment to work. And what a machine needs isn't necessarily what a human being needs. Like, they don't need windows, they don't need daylighting. There's a whole list of things that machines don't necessarily need that humans do. And so what I'm proposing here is that we separate these two worlds. We let the machine world be the machine world and the human world be the human world. And so this is a tower, and everything goes in the tower. There's like 42 floors of parking. All the stacks are up here. There's 3D printers and cafes and all this stuff. And so when you come to the site, you drive directly into the paper factory. You get out of your car, it's robotically lifted up and stored into this thing. And you come out this other side into this sort of paradise of follies. And the idea is you just have pure leisure and everything you want is delivered to you. So if you want a cup of coffee or a milkshake, you order on an iPad, this tower produces it, sends it down an elevator, and delivers it directly to you. So that's the idea. That's the idea. So I'm setting up these two worlds. Right? So it's like these two... I guess you could call them heterotopias. It's like the machine environment and the human, and then the site becomes a sort of densely forested area with these follies, and you sort of experience it that way. And so I have these two conceptual images, one of them being the tower as sort of this monstrosity that we all live with and refuse to acknowledge because it's to a degree it's invisible. You can't see what's happening when you order something on Amazon. So this is like manifesting that and making it visible. And then that in conjunction with the human realm, which is this densely forested sort of place where you go, and it's like a pure hedonistic world that might be like some sort of future condition. And when you enter, you have this like statue of Dionysus like welcoming you into this world. So I hope that made sense.
Can you explain like about like the volume?
So these are the follies. They're just abstractions. I don't know what the actual shapes are going to be. I still need to design them. And there's
something going on.
So if you're a kid, you're going to order a milkshake, obviously. So you order your milkshake, and it comes down an elevator, and goes underground through this underground conveyor system, and pops up through the floor of these follies. So wherever you are, whatever you want, whether it's a book or a piece from the, a toy from the gallery or a shake or whatever, it sort of gets delivered to you.
That's Pinocchio's nose.
Okay, one more. Any other questions for?
Hi everyone, my name is Jose. The Pinocchio Library project is took a different stance to me.
personally, because this is a small town or a suburb of a bigger city, and coming from a city that, well, I'm from Las Vegas, so coming from a city that's part of that, and I'm from one of the suburbs called Henderson, and I used to work as a tour guide over at the Hoover Dam, and thinking about this project as being this massive thing that's going to interrupt the city, the way that it looks, the way that it flows, and similar to like the Hoover Dam, the way that it responds into the seasons, the majority of the time during the winter time, during certain times of the season when school's in, this place is, you know, the Hoover Dam is massively empty, and this to the citizens in Henderson is a really big downturn, and also for Boulder City. So the way that I thought about this project is similar in the same way. So the idea was to maybe propose a different way, maybe a bigger step back, where the library is a portion of something bigger. I'm thinking about it that it's more of a archive space, or it might be something for the locals to have year round, or it might be a separate library, a gallery, and then the library portion that ties into the Pinocchio Park. So within that state of mind, this project begins to have something that becomes a little bit more year-round, something that doesn't necessarily have to be completely attached to the Pinocchio place, and kind of responds to the, I guess, the economic circumstance or the, I guess the community at large, or the city at large. I found the site really daunting in terms of what the program and the amount of square footage we had. No matter what gets popped in here, no matter like how many things you do to avoid it, this thing's always going to have some sort of scar on it or something that really sticks out, no matter how I guess you try to blend it, in my opinion. So what I decided to do is look at reducing a lot of the things that were there. And the one thing that I decided to keep was the paper factory. And the paper factory was one of the biggest massing logics that I had behind it. So I took the proportioning of the massing of the paper factory, took it, and to fit all the program, there had to be around 8 or 9 to enveloping 3 stories to fit all the program, minus the parking. And as you can see in the area distribution, you would see that the parking takes up more, and then all the colored bars would be what those would be. So looking at that, you would have so much area that would take up in relation to that. Since I fragmented a lot of the programming already, there had to be a way to organize this project. And what I decided to do is take these lines of axes in the way that some of the buildings already had organized themselves around the hillsides, in relation to the river and the hillside. So each one of these were these bars that then helped inform how each one of these rectangles were placed. So from there, within the axes and the way that they flow together, there was these two major thoroughfares, plus the roads that would then subtract from these long rectilinear bars that would connect everything together. And from there, you would end up with a diagram that would be something like this, which then ended up becoming the project, or this version of the project, that then kind of tied in a lot of the parking from the experience, resolved a lot of the issues tying in with the city and the way that this is kind of figured out with the buses, the bus parking that they had already, and so some of these just play on different flavors so this major bar right here represents the gallery, the auditorium, that if you're one of the tourists, you could stay contained with this volume. If you're visiting the Pinocchio Park, you would stay contained within this area where the library and the toy library and some of the galleries are. And if you're a local, there's a cafe and some of the media library and a local library in this portion that would tie that portion together. So these are separate volumes that could be enclosed or used for different events throughout the year. So you don't have to have a big volume. Some of them could be closed off, and you would still use part of the site throughout the year. Some of the sections demonstrate some of the way that I was breaking up the verticality of it by subtracting through the river, the circulation, and some of the vertical aspects. So when I was taking through the
to each one of the floors of the of the paper factory. So, yeah, that's what I got. Thanks.
Go to the bell.
Yeah, so we got 10 minutes. So I think what's, I mean, that's good. It was tighter than I thought it was going to be. So I think just let's jump in, start either asking questions, then it can continue at lunch or even thereafter. So anyone's welcome to jump in at any of the three.
I'm chomping the tower. Jump into that.
Sure.
I guess I'll let other people discuss like your premises and how you arrived at this. Luckily, you have this big slab tower, and it kind of needs to justify itself. Right? So it needs to be really elegant. It needs to have an experiential payoff to it. So, you know, I think at this point you roll with this. But how do you structure this? How do you scheme it? It becomes a really interesting problem. I don't know if you looked at Jimmy Ishigami's tower project. He called it like houses in the sky or something. Conceived these like really spindly towers with really delicate structure. Each floor plate is its own kind of entity and own experience. So I think like this can work if the architecture and structure step up and realize this as a worthwhile exploration. And you know, then at that point, I'm not sure if the follies even make sense. You know, this thing is a folly, right? It's a sit. More in the middle of the site, like how you orient it is really crucial, how it casts a shadow, how it's oriented to the light. I'm not sure you want to mess with the existing paper factory at that point, this thing can be a follow destination. But I think you're onto something interesting, but you have a large task, I think, to justify this through the actual architecture and structure. And I don't know if other people disagree with the premise and how you arrive at making the tower in the first place, but I think it's worthwhile if you can pull it off technically and deteriorate and experimentally.
See, I guess I would push back against that comment. Actually, I would detail this as straightforward and cheap and a fit. Like, it would be the most banal tower ever, but it would work and it would be cheap and it would be constructed, right? And then that's, I think, where the strength of the follies in contrast to that. Because this would be a great Black Mirror episode, for sure. Like, this is like, it's got all the pieces to it, right? It's got this daunting monolith in the background. It's got this weird thing that I always get my drink everywhere and so forth. So I think at that point, like, I think we're all on board with the tower. So I really think you need to find the...
You're not on board, not on board with the tower.
Well,
that
was
the
counterpoint
is that thing is so skinny and delicate that I don't think it can be made cheap.
Exactly.
That's the problem.
Well,
that's the problem. That's why I think
look,
it has to go to the extreme.
Made to look cheap.
Okay.
It's,
this,
well,
it's,
it's a parafiction, right? I mean, we're talking about a fictional like genre here, and I think parafiction is the perfect way to go with this. Make it look dumb, but obviously it can't be dumb, right? And it's that discovery and that offness between like what we thought we perceived versus what the actual reality of it is, or what that reality actually is, would be the strength of the tower. In regards to your project, I'm just going to rapid fire the three real quick. I think you did a really good due diligence to midterm programming exercise. And I think your step forward would be questioning what's a good kind of conceptual, like, what lends agency to this now? Like, you got the pieces kind of roughly where they should be, but like, this is the diagram to push against now, right? Every step forward should be to push against this diagram, not to be this at the end of the day. Because there's good stuff here, and when you push against it, you're gonna find you're gonna have an interesting result between kind of what you come up with as far as that aesthetic goes with the actual program. And then for you, I think the, you know, it's interesting you call out these three things. However, you know, they're all kind of void of the actual task at hand, which is a children's museum and so forth. These are just like aspirations, personal. They seem like they're personal aspirations of what the building might be. And not to say that's a bad start, but I'd say start pumping this thing with like, okay, it's a children's museum, the whale thing's kind of there. Scale might be off now for kids and so forth. Just like, I would just use this, you know? This was your first staff, and then just start pumping the fun into it.
There's aspects of it, like, the didactic quality, like, describing how the systems are exposed. The systems that can really work in the Children's Museum, maybe it's finding connections with the Children's Museum, library, with started with. This image is pretty powerful. I mean, it's just like a screenshot of like this kind of overlaying and ghosting. Maybe that's just how printing would be created, but kind of ghosting of different layers could be a good start in terms of like stimulating activity and stimulating kids.
I think it's three strategies. They're all pretty successful at, like, as midterm kind of statements. I think like each one of you has like a word that you're kind of working around. Like, I love the idea of fog, like architectural fog. And I think you're using the tools of an adult architect space maker to define your library right now. And I think you should jump back and try to figure out what other means of representation you can use for fog. I got off the top of my head, I was thinking of these kind of vertical climbing structures that are now, that there's a net around them, and they're still structural, and there's all these platforms, and kids just figure it out, right? And when I see your perspectives, like, I want that to be even blurrier. Like, is it more structure? Is it more net? Is it, like, what is this space? I kind of don't want to know, but want to be able to, in some capacity, like, have a room, you know?
Scale is really important.
Right.
To have.
Yeah, like your mathematics.
This is too architectural.
Right. Your mathematics, like, figure out how small you can make a column and what that grid looks like, and then figure out.
Yeah, I was trying to do that yesterday, and then
my grasshopper doesn't
work.
Just do it with dots on paper.
It's a relationship to what you want the scale to be,
right.
And then we can kind of work from there.
I think the three. Sorry.
No, you're good.
I feel very interested in your three guys. Yeah. The very different approach,
yeah,
to dealing with this idea. The Xinjiang's one is more like a sponge,
right.
More like a kind of a developed system. Is more interesting, like the case like you know, you talk, you know, like go up and down. In general, you create a lot of intimate space. Translucent is more like sponge to contain all the flow. This, you know, he did is like a vertical, and more like, if I'm talking about your span, you're more like a jump. I'm thinking about bring case up and then jump to the, you can see, you know, maybe body inside Earth, but you left something,
yeah,
you know, above Earth. I think playing the vertical experience is kind of interesting, but you're one more like, once again, like a cross. You know, basically you're making all the things more like cross river to dialogue with, you know, this you know, this river. I feel it's kind of a, you know, interesting,
mm-hmm,
word that was about.
It's funny that you guys are all presenting together at the same time,
yeah,
because they're all so different, right? So yours is the real, yours is the lie, and yours is kind of the established in some ways. So, like, in your case, if you want to really investigate fog, like, I'm more interested in physical things, so you could do start layering layers of glass, like different layers of facade glass studies, and start to create the kind of misty fog effect versus, let's say, you know, adding fog machines to create a kind of fog effect. But I find that less interesting than this idea of opening up this kind of green space. Like, maybe that's what the project is, and the building wants to be a little bit less sophisticated in some ways. So I would encourage you to really look at that open space as a problem, kind of architectural problem, that might start to suggest.
It's a landscape solution.
Sure, but I still think you're doing things in composition. Like, look at this here, and then look at this here. Right? There's a play between both of these, which I don't think you've given enough attention to the open grass space, which I would encourage you to look at. Your project, I love. Right? You've created a lie, and you're trying to make a building, which I don't think you should be doing. I think you should hold on to the lie and make it into this kind of speculative narrative. Right? This idea of a kind of narrative or the kind of story, and it doesn't want to be a building. You completely lost me when there was milkshakes coming down from the building. But I don't care this thing's built. It doesn't ever want to be built. I mean, the wind alone would knock it over if we tried to build it. And it's not a project about building. Right? It's a project about an aspiration towards narrative and speculative architecture in some ways. And so it's up to you to figure out how you represent this. Right? So I don't think you need to have slabs of program. It's you need these kind of utopian visionary perspectives and how you start to operate. And then this one, this really feels like a campus. You've created a university campus, which suggests this kind of prestige. And so I would like look at the Forum, at the Colosseum, like still well-known Italian architecture characteristics, and how you might use those in a kind of contemporary context. Because
these aren't piazzas. It feels really like a university campus, right? But I like that.
It's like a quad.
Yeah, and I think that's the project, right? And so it's super clear, all three of these, and you just have to go with it, right? Follow your intuition, and just go with it.
Yeah, for the tower one, I'm kind of against the tower in the sense that you're using, like, architecture is such an old technology to do anything. And you're kind of running into that when you try to draw floor plates of an old technology that's just delivering milkshakes, right? And I think that's where it becomes a fairy tale and a kind of story. But then I wonder, like, all right, if it is about, like, if we, let's say, try to make it a real project, like, and it's about this delivery of stuff to people, like, is that, like, drones can do that. And you don't need a building, or the building doesn't need to be here, right? Or, like, how... What are the conditions of today that kind of dictate our use of space, and see if there's an architectural way, or where does architecture fit into that system is like a larger issue of today versus the fairy tale. So I think you have to pick your kind of your battle, and I appreciate the fairy tale.
It's a good project, but we all have an opinion, right? We're all debating.
Right.
That makes it a successful project. We're all projecting our own aspiration.
What I was going to jump is that this has to get to like a wall section.
Yeah,
so there could be, but to build on what he's saying too, I mean, this could be not occupied, right? This could be a tower.
But it is occupied.
Yeah, and so, but then, how do you justify then milkshake delivery? How do you justify it if this is not occupied? And then the follies become important. The treatment of the landscape.
Right.
9/11, the World Trade Center competition. You should look at Tom Ames' entry. So he did a project where instead of doing rebuilding the tower, he did a kind of a tower that fell right on the ground. So all the program was in the city, but then he built these like really tall vertical, almost just
follies.
Yeah, pretty much big follies. They weren't occupiable, but you could see from the city. You should look at that as a precedent for an actual, they actually built that in some ways.
And a compromise maybe to that point, like that's why I suggested parafiction is maybe the way to represent this, because again, you work through it as though it is real. Detail it in the section and so forth, and that's how you represent it. So now it becomes really uncanny because now you see this giant worked out thing with like, and I would start to like push it out on social media and freak people out that this might be coming to like this town in Italy and so forth and get that response. Like build it into that kind of narrative, and because there's a potency in that, that would, I think, get you to a point where you kind of like nice grounded fictional architectural project.
If you, just for a thought experiment, invert it, right? Like your delivery method is coming from the ground and your follies are vertical. Like see what that gives you,
Like put everything underground?
Yeah, that's a warehouse, right? It's follies sticking out of a warehouse versus the follies being the warehouse, or the ground. And just, see. Because I think that this idea of what delivers what and what takes precedent, like is it about putting people high to see out? Because right now nobody occupies this.
Nobody goes inside.
Right. So I would challenge it, see what happens.
So Tom Mee proposed a tower for thermal vault.
Right.
I said that. I think it would be literally had to.
You need a scaffolding, right? This could be just scaffolding as a special mesh. And if no one ever occupies it, you totally can do that. Yeah, it would do that.
And I think if you wrap it somehow,
it's going to fall over.
Richard, it's interesting that you chose to represent your tower with these appendages or cloud. It's actually wide over. And you've got this big cloud right next to it. Why not actually incorporate those clouds into your building, form of those clouds? As a kid arriving, you see this incredible fantasy of a tower with clouds colliding. And then through your skinning of the building, how to dissolve beyond the clouds into pure nothingness.
It's a billboard already, so that's perfect.
Driving to town, see this.
Yeah.
Yeah, there is a smokestack. I think Richard still has next to it.
Yep.
I don't know about you guys, but when I was a kid, I thought smokestacks made clouds.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Should be a cloud factory.
Yeah.
I think you're crushing the paper factories. A pretty uncomfortable, totally different conversation. I would move it off the paper factory. The fascinating, great building, except you're just chugging the crushing with a foot on.
Then he's got no limits in terms of what his footprint is. That's the only reason I realize is that we need to, like, all code compliant, and you, I feel like you could build this.
that's its funny part. It's like,
it fits the code, and you can put an oil slab on the top and die grid it, and you could build this and it'll stand up. I really think you could. I think you could make it realistic.
This is a suspension, you know, maybe like a grid. I've seen that kind of idea, like trying to achieve like a structural mystery with grid or like a small elements. But something about suspension is kind of interesting too. That might be like more of a fog as opposed to a post and beam assembly. So I might look into that as a driving force. There needs to be more than I think.
It's been challenging doing that part.
The parking's going to make this thing way too heavy. I would get rid of it, and you can make it even skinnier. Like, what's the skinniest you can make it and still have it comfortable as a, like, maybe it's only like 6 feet wide. Like, that's just enough for like kids to kind of use enough of a couch. You just feel like you're in this giant treehouse.
Because it wants to.
Because it has to. This is like another project. This is like a.
This was the original idea. That's what this is.
Are these meant to go into how you distill your ideas and get them more refined?
These would be like the building materials. All the chimney all point towards the top of the tower. So wherever you are, you just like tower. But originally, this is where the other.
I see.
Then you also
in your booklet you had this really crazy sponge like these two layers of sponges, these two ceramic pieces.
Yeah, I've been working on that too.
That's another project too. That's more like Connor's project. It's like this kind of crawling thing.
It's not the same. This works.
Yeah, you gotta get off of it. I know, like, can you convince?
I like some colors.
Yeah, convince us by having a